Now, I'd like to read a piece of prose that, again, using some great writer's phrase, a piece of work in progress. And this is part of a short story. It's going to be a fairly long story. I'm trying to avoid the word novel, called Adventures in the Skin Trade. And this little bit begins when a young man comes to London for the first time and goes into the bar of Paddington Station. Nip of bass, please, and a ham sandwich. He took them to a table in a corner, brushed off the crumbs with his wet hat, and sat down just before noon. He counted his money. £8.09, nearly £3 more than he'd ever had in his life. Some people had this every week. It had to last him until he was dead. At the next table sat a plump, middle-aged man with a chocolate-brown birthmark over his cheek and chin like the half of a beard. He was propping his book against an empty bottle when a young man walked over to him from the counter. Hello, Sam. Hello, Ron. Fancy seeing you. He was Ronald Bishop, who used to live in the Crescent off Stanley's Grove. Been up on the smoke for long, Sam? Oh, just arrived, those tracks. Oh, same as me. We must be in the same train. Oh, so. Still the old same game, Sam? Yes, up in the business. You at the usual? Yeah. They had never had anything to say to each other. Where are you staying, Ron? Oh, usual, Strand Palace. Oh, I guess I'll be seeing you then. Okay. Make it tomorrow in the bar about 7:30. Okay. It's a date, don't forget. No fear. They both forgot it at once. Well, I'll be seeing you. Be good. As Ronald Bishop walked off, Samuel said silently into his glass, a fine beginning. If I go out of the station and turn round the corner, I'll be back in number 42. The little Probats will be playing doctors outside the load of hay. The only stranger anywhere near me is a businessman with a stained face reading the palms of his hands. No, here comes a woman in a fur coat. She's going to sit next to me. Yes, no. I smelt her as she passed. Eau de cologne and powder and bed. The woman sat down two tables away, crossed her legs, powdered her nose. This is the beginning of an advance. Now she is pretending not to notice that her knees are uncovered. There's a lynx in the room, lady. Button your overcoat. She's rattling her spoon and her saucer to attract my attention. But when I stare at her hard without smiling, I see she is looking down gently and innocently into her lap as though she had a baby there. He was glad she was not brazen. Dear mother, he wrote with his finger on the back of an envelope, looking up between every few invisible words at the unnoticing woman opposite. This is to tell you that I arrived safe and that I am drinking in the buffet with a tart. I will tell you later if she is Irish. She is about 38 years old, and her husband left her 5 years ago because of her carryings on. Her child is in a home, and she visits him every other Sunday. She always tells him that she is working in a hat shop. You need not worry that she will take all my money, as we loved each other on first sight. And you need not worry that I shall break my heart trying to reform her, because I have always been brought up to believe that Mortimer Street, where I was born, is what is right, and I would not wish that on anybody. Besides, I do not want to reform her. Not that I think she is nasty. Her business is very hard on stockings, so I'm going to pay the first week's rent for our little room in Pimlico. Now she is going across to the counter to buy another cup of coffee. I hope you will notice that she is buying her own. Everybody in the buffet is unhappy except me. As she came back to her table, he tore up the envelope and stared at her unsmiling for a full minute by the Bovril clock. Once she raised her eyes to his, then looked away. She was tapping her spoon on the side of her cup, then opening and closing the clasp of her handbag, then turning her head round slowly to face him, and then looking again away quickly through the window. She must be new, he thought with a sudden compassion. But he did not stop staring. Should I wink? He tilted his hard, wet hat over one eye and winked. A long, deliberate wink that screwed up his face and made his burning cigarette nearly touch the blunt end of his nose. She snapped her handbag, pushed two pennies under the saucer, and walked right out of the room, never looking at him as she passed. She's left her coffee, he thought. And then, my God, she was blushing. A fine beginning. Did you speak? Asked the man with the birthmark spying up. His face was red and purple where it wasn't brown, faintly shabby and unshaved, shiftily angry about the eyes, as though his cunning were an irritation impossible to bear. I think I said it was a fine day. Stranger in town? Yes, I've just come up. How do you like it? He did not appear to care at all. I haven't been outside the station yet. Now the woman in the fur coat would be telling a policeman, I have just been winked at by a short boy wearing a wet hat. But it isn't raining, madam. That would settle up. He put his hat under the table. There's plenty to see, the man said, if that's what you want. Museums, art galleries. Without speaking, he went through a list of other attractions. Museums, he said after a long pause. There's one at South Kensington, and there's a British Museum, and there's one at Whitehall with guns. I've seen them all, he said. Now every table was occupied. Cold, stiff people with time to kill sat staring at their tea and the clock, inventing replies to questions that would not be asked, justifying their behavior in the past and the future, drowning every present moment as soon as it began to breathe, lying and wishing, missing all the trains and the terrors of their minds, alone at the terminus. Time was dying all over the room. And then all the tables except the one next to Samuel's were unoccupied again. The lonely crowd went out in a funeral procession, leaving ash and tea leaves and newspapers. You must move out of a station sometimes, you know, the man said, returning to a conversation that had no interest to him. If you want to see around, it's only fair. It's not fair to come up on a train and sit in a buffet and then go back and say you've seen London, is it? I'm going out now, quite soon. That's right, Manson. Give London a chance. He is so tired of talking to me that he is nearly losing his temper, Samuel thought. He looked around him again, at the mourners fidgeting to the counter, at the quick whiskey drinkers in a knot by the tea urn, at the waitresses listlessly busy with cardboard cakes and small change. Otherwise, it's like not getting out of bed, isn't it? The man said. You've got to walk around, you know. You've got to move around sometime. Everybody does it, he said in a sudden, dull passion. Samuel bought another nip of Bass from a girl like Joan Crawford. This is the last one. Then I'm going, he said when it returned to his table. Do you think I care how many more you have? You can stay here all day. Why should I mind? The man was looking at the palms of his hands again as his temper mounted. Am I my brother's keeper? Ronald Bishop stood still at the counter. Mortimer Street has tracked me down, Samuel thought bitterly, even into this lopsided quarrel with a palmist in a station restaurant. There was no escape. But it was not escape he wanted. The street was a safe hole in a wall behind the wind in another country. He wanted to arrive and be caught. Rommel stood there like a fury with a rolled umbrella. Come in, Mrs. Rosser, in your fawn and beige antimacassar coat with your tribal hat on your waves, and scream the news of the street across the table in your whist-dry voice. I could not escape your fury on a bird's rock. You would be mincing and pinching down to the fishy sea with your beak gaped open like a shopping bag. I hate a nosy Parker, the man said, and got up. On his way to the counter, he passed the table where the Irish prostitute had sat and removed the pennies from under the plate. Stop, thief, said Samuel softly. No one could hear. There is a waitress with a consumptive husband who needs those pennies, and two children, Tristram and Eve. He changed the names quickly, Tom and Marge. Then he walked over and put a sixpence under the plate just as a waitress came to the table. It fell on the floor, he said.
Oh, yeah?
As he walked back, he saw that the waitress was talking to three men at the counter and nodding her head in his direction. One man was Ronald Bishop. One was the man with the birthmark.
Oh, fine, fine. If he had not broken the china at home before he left, he would have caught the next train back. The pieces would be swept up by now, but the tears would be running all over the house. Mother, mother, he's put my crochet work up the chimney. He heard his sister scream in a guard's whistle. Get me a rubber to rub out coal, Hilda. I shall, of course, lose my position. That is only to be expected. Oh, my teapot. Oh, my blue set. Oh, my poor boy.
He refused to look at the counter where Ronald Bishop inaudibly reviled him. The waitress knew, as soon as she saw him, that he stole from the begging tins of the blind and led them by the arm into thick traffic. The birthmarked man said that he had shown him a certain postcard and then had shown it to a customer in a fur coat. The voices of his parents condemned above the clattering of cups. He stared hard at his book, though the print climbed and staggered as if the tears of the left house had run down after him along the rails and flowed into this hot, suspicious room over the tea-stained air into his eyes. But the image was false, and the book was chosen for strangers. He did not like or understand it. My bills, my doilies, my willow plate. Ronald Bishop went out onto the platform.
Be seeing you, Ron.
Ronald Bishop's face was flushed with the embarrassment of not noticing him.
One pleasure is, said Samuel to himself, that I do not know what I expect to happen to me.
He smiled at the waitress behind the counter, and she stared away at once as guiltily as though he had discovered her robbing the till. I am not so innocent as I make out, he thought. I do not expect any old cobwebbed Fagin reeking of character and stories to shuffle out of a corner and lead me away into his grand, loud, filthy house. There won't be any Nancy to tickle my fancy in a kitchen full of handkerchiefs and beckoning unmade beds. I did not think a choir of loose women would immediately sing and dance around the little tables in plush cloths and advertised brassieres as I walked into London for the first time, rattling my fortune fresh as Copperfield. I could count the straws in my hair with one hand.
Hush! I know you, he said. Cheater at patience, keyhole peeper, keeper of nail clippings and earwax, lusting after silhouettes on Laburnum's blind, searching for thighs in the library of classical favorites, Sam Thumb in the manhole, crying up on windy days. I am not like that at
talk,
he said, as the man with the birthmark came over to the table and sat down opposite him.
I thought you were going, the man said. You told me you were going. You've been here an hour now.
I saw you, Samuel said.
I know you saw me. You must have seen me, mustn't you? Because you were looking at me, the man said. Not that I want the tuppence. I've got a house full of furniture. 3 rooms, full to the ceiling. I've got enough chairs for everyone in Paddington to have a sit down. Tuppence is tuppence, he said. But it was tuppence to the waitress, too. She's got 6 pence now, hasn't she? She's made 4 pence clear. It doesn't do any harm to you just because she thinks you were trying to nip it off her. It was my 6 pence. The man raised his hands. The palms were covered with calculations in ink. And they talk about equality. Does it matter whose 6 pence it is? It might have been mine or anybody's. They were calling the manageress, he said, but I put down my foot there. They were both silent for several minutes. Made up your mind where you're going when you move out of here? The man said at last. Because move you must sometime, you know.
I don't know where I'm going. I haven't any idea in the world. That's why I came to London. Look here, the man said, controlling his voice. There's sense in everything. There's bound to be. Otherwise, we wouldn't be able to carry on, would we? Everybody knows where he's going, especially if he comes by train. Otherwise, he wouldn't move where he took the train from. That's elementary. People run away. Have you run away? No. Then don't say it.
Don't say it!
His voice trembled. He looked at the figures in his palms. Then, gently and patiently, he began again. Let's get this thing straight. People who have come must go. People must know where they're going, otherwise the world would not be conducted on a sane basis. The streets would be full of people just wandering about, wouldn't they? Wandering about and having useless arguments with people who know where they're going. My name is Ellingham. I live in Cyril Street off Praed Street, and I'm a furniture dealer. That's simple, isn't it? There's no need to complicate things if you keep your head and know where you are. I'm Samuel Bennett. I don't live anywhere at all. I don't do any work either.